right? So it is nice and early in the morning, so I figured we'd talk about...
All right, everyone, getting started.
Some drugs. There we are. So, this is the core content lecture, of course. It's like bread and butter, EM stuff. I'm going to try and just cover a general review of some illicit drugs that you will see patients presenting intoxicated with to the emergency department, and management of the problems that follow. So first things first, you want to stay broad in your thinking of these patients. A lot of these toxidromes include hyperthermia, tachycardia, you know, and they're altered, of course, right? So it's a fine line between LP, you know, encephalitis, and going down another route, which is benzos, seeing their response to that. But just keep in mind all of the other diagnoses that go along with altered mental status, and anchoring to intoxication is not a good thing. So right after vital signs, you want to get a finger stick, of course. That should go along with your vital signs. And then neuro exam. And a lot of people just send basic labs on these people, if not more, depending on substance. History is really important. You want them to admit, you know, exactly what they took, how much they took. You know, that's really the what's going to give you most information often. Cocaine. So cocaine, it increases the amount of serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine available in your system. Also, a voltage-gated sodium channel blocker. So basically, it follows, a lot of the sequelae that follow are this sympathomimetic toxidrome. But then also the voltage-gated sodium channel blocker leading to arrhythmias. Now, there are many dangerous diagnoses that are associated with cocaine as well, like intracranial hemorrhage, aortic dissection. These people are very susceptible to some of these more devastating events. There's going to be a lot of repetition. I apologize for that, but benzos are the way to go with a lot of these drugs, kind of decreasing the catecholamine release. Is really important for the management of a lot of stimulants. Also, the blood pressure management in cocaine, the recommended, as well as a lot of these stimulants, is phentolamine. It's phentolamine IV pushes is also recommended. It is a the mechanism of that drug. It counteracts the alpha adrenergic effects of cocaine. Now, beta blockers, of course, as we all know, because it pops up on every single exam, are contraindicated in cocaine intoxication. The evidence for that is not fantastic. But it's something that you have other options. You should avoid that. EKGs and cardiac enzymes on basically all of these people, certainly EKGs, and then think of the more dangerous sequelae. You know, it's probably very difficult to differentiate between someone who's really rambunctious from cocaine and a head bleed. So intracranial hemorrhages are associated with cocaine use. So keep these things in mind. So more extensive testing when indicated. Synthetic stimulants. So first, amphetamines. So this is a really broad group. here. Bath salts is another kind of more recently emerging one, which is a cathinone. People that use amphetamines use them in various routes, snorting them, smoking them, injecting them. Injecting them is more common than a lot of people think. Also, so, you know, think about IV, you know, all the things that go along with IV drug abuse there. Again, it's that increase of serotonin, dopamine, and norepinephrine available. And it is that sympathomimetic syndrome that we see with cocaine as well. Now, also with amphetamines, you can see serotonin syndrome, and that is something to keep in mind. Now with these people, the effects of some of these amphetamines last a lot longer, over 6 hours, 10 hours sometimes, so that's good to keep that in mind. Succinylcholine should be avoided in these patients for risk of hyperthermia and hyperkalemia. And looking through a lot of the stimulants, the relative contraindication or avoidance of succinylcholine pops up. That said, you know, you have other drugs that are at your disposal. Ecstasy. So ecstasy, popular party drug. It is, as you see in all capital letters, methamphetamine, despite what your friends say. So it's a mechanism that is like meth a little bit. However, it's more serotonin. It sort of provides that disinhibition, the euphoric feeling. So all that sympathomimetic stuff applies to ecstasy as well. Plus hyponatremia. Now the mechanism of the hyponatremia is thought to be primary polydipsia, as well as a drug-induced syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. So basically anybody saying they did ecstasy and coming to an ER should get a BNP at least, right? All right, so also avoidance of beta blockers and haloperidol. Now, the beta blockers, that's for the same reason as cocaine. Now, I wasn't able to tease out whether that was for a concern for an adulterant, should be avoided. And then haloperidol is known to decrease the seizure threshold, and should be avoided for that reason, as well as their. Another thing you want to think about is Tylenol and salicylate levels in these people. There are a number of adulterants. Ecstasy is just some pill. Really no saying exactly what's in it. So a comp looking for hepatotoxic adulterants is appropriate. And then in management of the hyponatremia, if someone is symptomatic and under 120, you would start out with the 100 ml bolus of 3% saline. Now, I'm not sure exactly how you tell if someone's symptomatic, short of them seizuring when they're acutely intoxicated. So if they're under 120, I think it'd be a good idea.
One thing that you can see with ecstasy that I have seen actually is rhabdo, and that's one of the reasons, and NMS, even if you use the haloperidol. That's one of the reasons you want to avoid haloperidol. There's an increased incidence of MMS with it, as well as those have to worry about QT widening. But I've seen rhabdo with this.
Yeah, that one. I'll get to the slide with all of the sympathomimetics. Rhabdo is something that comes up over and over again with these people.
I don't think I give it 3% unless there are actually some. Just fluid restriction.
Okay, fluid restriction.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think I would give it.
PCP, this is sort of a novel mechanism here. It's interesting in its classification. Some classify it as a hallucinogen, dissociative, but it has a lot of the stimulant properties. Now it is an NMDA antagonist. It has some things that set it apart from those other sympathomimetics, the hallucinations more common, and then the like multi-directional nystagmus. I believe it's the vertical nystagmus, which is pathognomonic. So the effects of this drug are rather all over the place. I think the stereotypical PCP patient that we hear about is that sympathomimetic toxidrome and can become quite violent. But they also can present just completely catatonic. So these are tricky patients. And as with most of the sympathomimetics, benzos and a quiet place are good for these people. Not like three hallway, like more like room 10. So
you see these guys, they are very impressive. Very impressive. And because it was originally developed as an anesthetic for big farm animals, they don't feel pain. So they come in, you know, hallucinating. Sometimes they're hallucinating to themselves, so they're not wild. But if you bother them, they can feel wild and become wild. They also usually will have hypertension, and they will have that vertical nystagmus. So if you see a young person who's hallucinating and has hypertension and has vertical nystagmus, that triad really tells you it's PCP. And boy, as I once took me and this was when I was young and strong, me and four security guys at Lincoln to hold down this skinny little guy who took a swing at me as well, thought I was the devil and took a swing at me.
Yeah, I think Silverberg told me a story about somebody carrying a bed on their back, that PCP. So some superhuman stuff going on there with PCP. Try to avoid them inflicting violence on you and your fellow patients. So the sympathomimetic toxidrome, which applies to really these four at the top. So the agitation starting out with like 5 of IV valium would be okay. Hyperthermia, active cooling, these go along with all of these different substances. Rhabdo, common. So CK, urine myoglobin, looking at those in these patients, having a really low threshold to send labs on all of these people, really. Seizures, going through your typical seizure algorithm with benzos, phenobarb, and then controlling hypertension with phentolamine or nitroglycerin. Nitroprusside also is an option.
In MDMA toxicity, what do you do with the rhabdo and hyponatremia?
Come again?
In MDMA.
Yeah.
What do you do if they have rhabdo and hyponatremia?
Rhabdo and hyponatremia?
Well, I still would, you know, first I would sedate them. That helps, because that helps the muscle agitation. I would give them good amounts of benzos. And then I would hydrate the hell out of them. If they, even if they were hypernatremic, if they look dry, because sometimes they can be very hot, you have to cool them, but they're also can be dry. So you have to be careful. You have to evaluate their fluid status, whether you restrict them or whether you give them saline. A lot of times I have given them saline because they were so dry, and watch that. And then if they do seize, then you can try 3% normal saline. Only, again, I agree with Silverberg, like I always do. And I would only use that if they were symptomatic saline for seizures, then 3%. And, you know, and really support. You got to watch these guys. They can die on you.
The only problem with that is, like, they're already on a stimulant, so their chance of seizing is higher. So are they seizing because of the stimulant, or are they seizing because of the hypernatremia?
Right.
It's really hard to say. I would probably try to control with the benzo first, and if that was valid, then I would go to the 3%. But unless they're down under 110, I don't think they're going to seize from it. Yeah, that's pretty low to seize.
Yeah, the highest I've ever seen anyone seize with is around 111, 113. Anything above 115, I don't think I've ever seen seizures from hypernatremia.
Now, your big concern is like is raising your sodium too fast with your 3%.
Yeah.
My understanding is that 100 mils at 3% should just raise it about 2 or 3 or 4 maybe.
Yeah.
So I think, is it 12 in a day is the...
What's that? It's acute hypernatremia. So the correction rate
okay.
And also, you only correct them until they seem to be asymptomatic. And you know, I would usually, when I did this, and a couple times I had to correct it because they were really low, I would correct them to about 120 only. You don't have to correct them to normal.
Okay.
And most 125.
Right.
You can calculate. There's calculation of how much you use.
Right. Right. Yeah, there's a decalc thing for that. Yeah.
You're about to
yes.
What about
ciprofloxacin
for MDMA and paraphernin syndrome?
You can try it. It's not magic. I've used it. It only the problem with ciprofloxacin is it only comes orally, so you got to get it into them and stuff, and it's not a miracle. But I've used it for serotonin syndrome. The biggest thing in serotonin syndrome is support and sedation with benzos. And treat any complications you get. But yes, you can try it. Certainly you can try it. And I have.
So, I'll move on. So, yeah, basically with all of these sympathomimetics, again, benzos in a quiet place for these people, right? They need, they shouldn't be... we shouldn't be poking the bear there in three hallway. They need an appropriate room. Heroin, opioids, and current adulterants. So these people are probably okay with three hallway. You don't want to hide them in room 10 because they can stop breathing. So the big thing that you worry about with opioids is the respiratory depression. It also, of course, can cause some bradycardia, a little bit of hypotension, but those are considered not as worrisome as the respiratory depression. Fentanyl and methadone are common adulterants now in heroin. One thing to know about them, fentanyl, much more potent, methadone, much longer acting. So for those two different reasons, do they cause overdoses that just might exhaust your Narcan supply there? Narcan, the duration is about 30 or 45 minutes. So, you might push some Narcan, walk away for an hour, have some trauma code, and then come back and find that your patient's breathing at 2 a minute. Now, respiratory depression, what exactly is that? I skipped over that. So, you know, normal respiratory rate is like 12 to 16
despite all of our patients getting 20 in triage. So anything below like 10, thinking about Narcan, you know, definitely 8. And then also, you know, how much attention are you able to pay to this patient? You know, if they're breathing at 10, but a trauma code just came in, push the Narcan, I would think. Whereas if they're breathing at 10 and they've got a nurse right next to them, stimulating them, yeah, I don't know, it's dependent. Think about all of the other things that come along with IV drug abuse as well, HIV, hepatitis C, basically all infections, endocarditis. These people can be quite sick. So with Narcan, there is one thing you can do for Narcan pushes. You can take a 10 mil saline flush, or just draw up 9 mils of normal saline. You have little vials of Narcan that come in, naloxone, which come in 0.4 milligrams in 1 milliliter. So you would draw up that 1 mil. So then you would have 10 mils of this 0.04 per 1 mil push. So you can start out with people that are arousable. You know, let's say they're breathing at like 8, that they're, you know, schlogged sitting there. You can arouse them. You can start off at 0.04. The previous recommended doses had been starting out at 0.4. That was found to just basically throw a lot of these people into immediate withdrawal. You know, nobody wants that. So now the patient that's not breathing, this isn't the time to do the little pushes. You can then start out at 0.4. Some people are really afraid of those previously recommended dosages. One of the reasons is pulmonary edema with Narcan. Now this is something that's a little controversial. First of all, most of the deaths resulting from heroin overdose have some pulmonary edema. But that said, Narcan has been shown to cause some increased capillary pulmonary permeability in the lungs, some increased catecholamine release, which is thought to cause some pulmonary edema. So just be aware of that. It is real. So the patient that's in respiratory distress that's fully awake right after giving Narcan, think about that.
I think that's anecdotal. I really haven't seen it. We have given large amounts of Narcan very frequently, very often in the past, and I have not experienced that.
Yeah,
I think it's often the pulmonary edema is often the ARDS secondary to some alterants in the heroin that they injected. Mm. So I'm not so sure it's related to the Narcan. I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, Joel.
I think the big thing to worry about is their CO2 beforehand. If they're hypercapnic for a while, you're supposed to bag them first before you give it, and it doesn't happen supposedly.
Okay.
But